Hi, I'm Susan Taylor with Scripps Health in San Diego, California. Stem cells, there's a lot of hype around them. Do they work? Are they safe? And what about the role of 3D printing? Can you imagine your surgeon using a 3D printer right there in the operating room to print cartilage, living tissue, to then put into your arthritic knee to replace the bad tissue, to get rid of pain, and to actually restore the function of your knee? Well, here to talk about all kinds of advances in orthopedic research is Dr. Darryl D'Lima, who is the medical director of what we call SCORE here at Scripps, the Shiley Center for Orthopedic Research and Education. Thanks so much for being with us, Dr. D'Lima.
Thank you for inviting me.
Sure, let's talk about SCORE. When did it come into existence and what kind of wild things are you folks doing there?
So SCORE was founded by Dr. Caldwell, Clifford Caldwell, I believe in the 1980s. And it's been predominantly funded. The major donor that founded SCORE was the Shiley, Darlene Shiley. And
who was a major philanthropist around San Diego.
Right, right. And originally it was Dr. Caldwell was doing work on joint arthroplasty. And you can imagine in the 1980s, not all joint arthroplasties were successful.
Now, what's joint arthroplasty?
Joint replacement.
Okay.
So replacing your arthritic joint with metal and plastic. So at that time, the technology was still evolving. It wasn't as successful as it is now. And so we were constantly chasing the new designs, not knowing in advance which one was going to be successful and which one wasn't. And Dr. Caldwell did not want to rely on the manufacturers advertising or marketing, so he started by investigating his own patients. That means he would have a database in which every patient that got a joint replacement would be followed up for, I think the longest follow-up he had was 27 years
wow.
to date. So he knew very quickly when an implant did not work, and he was very meticulous in how he did the surgery. He did them all exactly the same way, so there was no other factor except for the change in the implant design. And I know of at least two cases in which I was also involved, where we found out before the FDA and we found out before the manufacturer made it public that the implant design was faulty. And we didn't put it in thousands of patients as the rest of the country did. And so that's how Scripps managed to help their own patients, because we were studying all these implant designs very carefully.
Talk about the e-knee. I know that SCORE was the only place in the entire U.S. that started testing what's called the e-knee.
Right.
The electronic knee.
So the electronic knee also was, the idea came from Dr. Caldwell, because at that time, we didn't know what the forces were inside someone's knee joint, especially after joint arthroplasty. Joint replacement. So we were using computer models and engineering physics to predict or calculate what the forces would be. So at Scripps, we designed and we developed and implanted an electronic knee. So it functions exactly like any other knee replacement implant, but it has sensors, it has a computer chip, it has a radio, it has remote power. And so it's sending data from the knee joint of the patient outside to a computer that can track all the activities that the patients were doing, all the way from walking, stair climbing, to sporting activities, and even skiing.
So data from the e-knee, well, typical knees last, joint replacements last what, 20 years, 25 years?
They historically and statistically, they last about 20 years with 80% success.
So data that you got from the e-knee showed that your knee will last longer if you do what?
So at least from the standpoint of forces, it seems like walking or running on a treadmill is generates less forces on your knee than jogging outside on, especially on uneven terrain.
And biking?
Biking is safe. We knew that tennis was not safe because it's a high impact sport. Surprisingly, skiing, depending on the type of slopes that you ski in, for example, greens and blues are okay, but when you get to
stay away from the moguls,
stay away from
the double black diamonds. And what about golf?
So that was a real surprise, because we didn't expect this. But when you swing a golf club on your leading knee, that means on a right-handed person, his left knee would be the leading knee. You can generate more than four times your body weight. That means as you swing your club, you're putting four times your body weight, which can be close to over 1,000 pounds on one knee.
So golf puts more stress on the knee.
Golf puts more stress on the knee, but unless you're a professional golfer who hits the ball thousands of times, the average golfer probably wouldn't have as much of a problem.
So if you're lucky enough to have a total knee replacement, you probably want the knee to last longer. You might have to, you know, cut back on your golf game once or twice a week.
Right.
So let's talk about osteoarthritis. What is it?
So osteoarthritis is caused by wear and tear of your joint. So there's this cartilage, and it's called articular cartilage, that lines the joint, and that is exquisitely lubricated. So in normal people, the wear and tear is really low. For some reason, in some patients it's because of trauma, in some patients because their bony anatomy has changed or their knees are not lined correctly, the surfaces start wearing out. That now creates a reaction in the joint, an inflammation in the joint, and then inflammation begins to eat away at the rest of the cartilage. And so now you end up having a joint that is swollen, that is painful, and as the cartilage wears away, you expose the bone below the cartilage. And so when you have now bone loading on bone, you can get extreme pain.
Can you repair knee cartilage?
At the moment, there's no clinically successful strategy for repairing knee cartilage.
So what about introducing stem cells?
So the hope of stem cells is that in the body, the stem cells are the cells that actually produce the tissues in your body. And so the scientific premise is that if you take stem cells and put them in your body or put them in an arthritic joint, they might now regenerate the lost tissue, the tissue that you lost because of osteoarthritis. So that's the hope. Unfortunately, that's not entirely true because we're still trying to assess the efficacy of why is it that some patients benefit from this treatment and some patients don't. And there's a whole line of stem cell therapy that's in the preclinical stage that hasn't even made it to patients yet.
So where are you in terms of the research now being able to use stem cells to regrow cartilage?
So we are tackling this at multiple fronts. For example, at the patient side of things, what the FDA allows is to take stem cells from your bone marrow and purify them and then re-inject them back in your knee joint or a diseased tissue. So we're testing that in patients, trying to identify which patients actually respond favorably to this treatment and which patients don't. So it's easy to imagine there are at least two factors. So there's the donor, that means my stem cells might be better or worse than somebody else's stem cells. And me as a patient, my tissues might heal or respond differently to injected stem cells than somebody else. So our hope is that if we can identify the differences between the patients that actually respond well to the patients that don't respond well, at a minimum, we should be able to pre-select the patients for whom this treatment is most indicated.
Are stem cells less effective the older a person is? What would be the ideal age if I was going to use my own stem cells?
Right. So the answer is statistically yes. With aging, the cells don't proliferate. That means they don't divide as readily as stem cells from a young person. With aging, they might produce less of the proteins that are needed to regenerate tissue. And then with aging, you might also carry on the diseases that that patient has accumulated over the years. They might be reflected in the stem cell population of that patient also.
So then flip to the other end of the spectrum. What about embryonic stem cells?
Right. So that we are still in the laboratory and preclinical stages of research. So embryonic stem cells now, as you correctly mentioned, is the extreme other side of the spectrum. These are cells that weren't even in a human body or were only in an embryo, were extracted from an embryo. So they have no disease attached to them at all. And they have this virtually unlimited capacity for dividing. So from a few cells, you can create thousands of doses, so-called doses of this cell. The other advantage of embryonic stem cell treatment is that you know what the potency of the cells is. You know how well these cells can change into a different cell type or can produce those proteins or factors that we're interested in. The downside of embryonic stem cell is twofold. One is that obviously it came from a different human. It came from an embryo. So there's a risk of what's called the immune rejection. which happens with, say, organ transplants, when they do organ transplants. And the second downside is because the embryonic stem cell can produce any tissue, and that's its natural function, once we put it in the body, there's no guarantee at the moment that it will only produce the tissue we want it to produce. What if it produces some other tissue? And those are called teratomas.
So where are you? I mean, if someone wants to sign up and they say, listen, I want stem cells in my knee because I've got terrible arthritis, right, and I don't want a total knee replacement. And this, I mean, the great part about this is to think that, well, if we really could inject these stem cells into the knee, then you wouldn't need the total knee replacement. It's faster healing. It's less expensive. The person gets back to moving at the speed of their life. If somebody wants to sign up, I mean, how close are you to actually doing clinical trials in people with this?
So with the autologous bone marrow-derived stem cell, that means stem cells from your own bone marrow, we are already treating patients with that type of stem cell treatment because that's allowed by the FDA. We are doing it under a clinical study because we want to understand why it works in only some patients some of the time. We're also looking at other adult stem cells. For example, there are stem cells in your fat that have some promise that's not yet approved or allowed by the FDA, and that we haven't started that study yet, but we are getting IRB approval or approval from our Human Subjects Research Committee to begin a study.
To see that it's safe
and that it actually benefits patients.
Are you looking 2 years down the line before you do the clinical trial, 5 years, 10 years?
Yeah, it could be as soon as this year.
Oh, really?
Because the technology exists, it's just a matter of making sure that we're doing it, we're following regulations.
So if somebody wants to sign up to be part of this clinical trial, how would they do that?
Call the Scripps Stem Cell Regenerative Clinic.
So technology, we want you to just think about this for a second. Technology is changing so fast. When you look down the road, when you peer into your crystal ball, what do you see 5, 10 years down the line? And we'll talk about that in just a couple of minutes. But I want to go back now and talk a little bit about this 3D bioprinting, which sounds like, science fiction, but you're talking about actually taking a printer into the operating room and printing live tissue out. How does this whole thing work?
Right. So most people have heard of 3D printing, and 3D printing is a different way of manufacturing objects from the ground up. So the traditional method of manufacturing an object is taking a block of marble, like Michelangelo did with David, and you take away the stuff that doesn't look like David. The other way of approaching it is by printing David drop by drop, and building an entire structure from scratch. What we are doing is that we're doing it with cells. So we can now construct a three-dimensional model of your tissue inside the laboratory. And not only can we construct the shape that matches the shape that needed for the patient, but we can also pick the cell type, and we can put the different materials in different layers because we're constructing this droplet by droplet and layer by layer. We call it an ink because we're printing, and we call it bio ink because we put cells in the ink. So after printing, you actually have now a live tissue that has been artificially printed.
It's so wild to think. Right. And most printers, though, today are like boxes. You hope to have a printer with kind of a robotic arm to actually print
right
inside somebody's body?
Yes. So it's a very ambitious project, and this was funded by the Schaefer Family Foundation that have been very generous. We've made progress with the box-like printers to show proof of concept. And now what we have is we've newly acquired a robotic arm that acts like a surgeon's arm, and we put a print head at the end of the robotic arm. And now that robotic arm is technically capable of printing inside a joint. We haven't done that in live joints yet, and it's still maybe 5, 10 years away from being tested in patients.
So if somebody wants to sign up for that, it's a little premature for that right now.
It's premature, but people sign up the infants for school.
but you think about what's the benefit to someone to have this 3D bioprinting. I mean, you're going to print like as a meniscus, right? Explain that in terms of a meniscus.
So when you lose tissue from the body, for example, you mentioned total joint replacement. Now, even if the patient loses only a part of the knee, if we have to do a total joint replacement, we've got to remove the entire knee. And we have to now fit that plastic or metal implant to the patient's bone. So we'll be taking off a lot of tissue, some of which or most of it may even be normal. We've got, just because we've got to make the artificial implant fit. Now we don't have to do that. We can only go in there and replace only that part of the tissue rather than resurfacing your entire carpet. We only replace the part of the carpet that is worn or stained or the one that requires replacement.
So it's faster healing?
It's faster healing.
Less trauma to the body?
Less trauma to the body.
Less expensive to the patient.
And less expensive. Maybe you should be writing a grant.
No. So are there risks to this? I mean, what are the risks?
There are obvious risks. For example, we've got to show that the robotic arm is safe, but robotics arm have been used in a lot of technology today, for example, manufacturing, especially cars. So that's a technical risk. There's a risk that the ink could cause a reaction to the patient, and there are ways to test for that. And then there's a risk that the cells might create something that's unanticipated, especially if they are stem cells.
So how is SCORE tackling the challenges facing this tissue engineering?
So we are moving stage-wise. So we have a pipeline, what we call a translational pipeline, when we take technology that's discovered in the lab to the patients. And so we're lucky that under one roof, one umbrella, one Scripps, we have capabilities to do laboratory studies where we do cell culture and tissue culture. Then we have preclinical studies where we have animal testing and big machines that do mechanical testing of clinical-sized product. And then finally, we have a very large clinical research services department that runs dozens of clinical trials.
It's one-stop shopping.
It's, for us at least, it's a one-stop shop.
All right, so we talked about this a couple of minutes ago. So now let's talk about the future discoveries or therapies that SCORE is working on. If you can, peer into your crystal ball, what are you most excited about looking 5-10 years down the line?
So I still think that some of the work that we are doing now might take more than 10 years. But if I had the time and the resources, one of the excitement about stem cells is they're like drug factories. So stem cells produce a lot of proteins and other compounds that can heal diseases, can even slow down aging. So what we're doing now is we don't know what the stem cells do, so we're putting in the factory inside the patient. But if we could tease out all the individual proteins that the stem cells were producing, maybe we wouldn't have to go back to a stem cell to do it. We would just have to give that specific protein or that specific disease-curing drug to the patient. So that's one of the areas that I'd like to explore.
Well, we are so appreciative of all of the research that you're doing and how you translate that to actually helping patients live more longer, more productive lives. So thank
great.
You, Dr.
Thank
D'Lima,
you.
Very much. If you'd like to learn more information about the great research that Dr. D'Lima and his team are doing at SCORE, the Shiley Center for Orthopedic Research and Education at Scripps, please just click on the link. If you'd like more critical information about your health, we take care of you at Scripps from head to toe, and we would urge you to please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel and also follow us on social media at Scripps Health. I'm Susan Taylor. Thanks so much for joining us. It is our mission at Scripps to help you heal, enhance, even save your life.